It's been a tough few months for Speaker Mike Johnson and GOP leadership as their House majority continues to slim. Wisconsin Representative Mike Gallagher is the latest Republican to retire, leaving the House GOP with a soon-to-be one-vote margin. With such a slim majority, it would only take a small number of Republicans to leave and give Democrats control of the House. That would be the first time control has ever flipped in the middle of a congressional term. But Republicans aren't only concerned with what's going on in the House. Their focus has narrowed in on the Senate battlefield. It's time to go on the record with Scott Tranter, Director of Data Science from Decision Desk HQ. Scott, thanks for joining me here. As always, many Americans are focused on the presidential election, but control of the Senate really could flip this year. Looking at Arizona, independent Kyrsten Sinema won't be seeking re-election. What are we seeing coming out of the Grand Canyon state in this matchup, which is set to be Ruben Gallego versus Carrie Lake?
Well, the Democrats feel a whole lot better now that Kyrsten Sinema is not in. You know, Ruben Gallego is polling pretty well against Carrie Lake, a couple points ahead, especially compared to some of the other Senate battlegrounds. Carrie Lake has been trying to tack to the middle, tactfully ignoring questions about, you know, election fraud from 2020, things like that, because she's trying to win back some of those more moderate Republicans and some of those independents. That's going to be a battleground for sure. Arizona also takes a wild account. We might not know the winner of that Senate race until, you know, 4 or 5, maybe a week after Election Day. And that could be the race that decides control of the Senate.
You know, moving back east, another very critical battleground state is Pennsylvania. We see that it's heating up there as Democrat Bob Casey and Republican David McCormick are really starting to campaign heavily. Do you think this will be an uphill battle for Republicans once again in that state?
Yeah, no. And look, David McCormick, second-time candidate, self-funding. You know, he would have been a great candidate 10, 15 years ago in Pennsylvania, more moderate, business focused. That's not exactly where today's GOP is. You know, Bob Casey, incumbent senator, good fundraiser, also good campaigner. You know, slight edge to the incumbent there just because that's how it is. But Pennsylvania is a presidential battleground. And right now, President Trump is pulling a couple of points ahead of Joe Biden in the state. So McCormick, if Trump wins the state, McCormick could be carried by Donald Trump's coattails.
Yeah, David McCormick ran in the 2022 Republican Senate primary, was notably defeated by Dr. Mehmet Oz, who was later defeated by Senator John Fetterman. So looking to the other battlegrounds in the Senate, what other races could we see impact control of the upper chamber?
So the two you're going to hear about a lot are Ohio and Montana. Ohio, they just had Bernie Moreno win a very contested GOP primary to go against Sherrod Brown. Bernie Moreno is probably the Democrats' preferred opponent just because of how MAGA he is and how he might turn off some of those more independent voters. But Ohio has been solidly red for a while, and it looks like Donald Trump is going to comfortably win there. Now, there's a long way to go, but that's going to be a focus race. So is Montana, where you have incumbent Senator John Tester. You know, he has been winning in that state, which has been solidly Republican for many cycles now. So he's favored. But the one dark horse race I would tell everyone to look out is look at Nevada. You know, we have incumbent Jackie Rosen. The Republicans are going to field a pretty good candidate there. You know, Jackie Rosen's certainly favored. But when we see some of these numbers about Republicans gaining some ground in the Latino vote, that's a state that could be a surprise win for the Republicans. And, you know, could be an interesting play for the Democrats. Do pull off an Ohio, Montana, but do not pull off a Nevada, they still might not maintain the Senate.
Yeah, we'll definitely keep an eye on Nevada and that Latino vote. And really, you know, that Latino vote across the country will be very consequential. Moving on to presidential politics, President Trump went on a Truth Social tirade, slamming House GOP members who are leaving their seats this year. What is the likelihood that we see a shift in power in the House?
You know, look, and as a former House congressional staffer, this is like everyone's favorite parlor game in D.C. It's like Survivor, but, you know, with members of Congress. From what I can tell and what I read, you know, it looks pretty likely. I mean, the odds are you're going to see another retirement. If it would be like Mike Gallagher's, would they leave before the end of the year? That would be pretty consequential. I know Mike Johnson's team is very intent on, you know, at least keeping it all together. What I look at is what does it do for potential elections this fall? You know, Mike Gallagher's seat's pretty safe. We look at Ken Buxton, also pretty safe, but maybe we get some of these more moderate, like a Mike Lawler up in New York, or some of these more moderate seats across the state. They just say, you know what, I'm done with this. I'm getting out now. We could see some contentious special elections this year that might flip the House.
You know, speaking of the House GOP, the Republican Freedom Caucus has been very vocal on Speaker Mike Johnson's job performance. You're a betting man, Scott, and a former congressional staffer, like you said. What are the odds that Johnson loses his job and ends up, you know, the same path that former Speaker Kevin McCarthy did?
Well, so I would bet a lot of money that he is not Speaker or not Majority Leader next year. I think the tougher bet is, does he survive the rest of the year? The Republicans and the Democrats came together. They figured out how to not have a government shutdown. So there's a couple of contentious bills over the rest of the summer, and then potentially a contentious CR. You know, if he basically survives the summer, he's probably got it, but you know, he's already had some issues. We'll see what this Ukraine vote brings. You know, Marjorie Taylor Greene with her motion to vacate. This long recess is never good for speakers and leaders when they have these contentious votes coming up. So we'll see. I would bet a small amount of money that he is at least speaker through the end of the year, but I would bet a lot of money he is not speaker or minority leader next year, no matter how the House goes.
So, Scott, on that note, though, you have this motion to vacate. You have the Freedom Caucus making all this noise once again. Do they have any idea of who they would replace Speaker Johnson with?
No, and, you know, that's the fun part for the news people, right? Like, we get to watch that chaos again. Jim Jordan has always said that, you know, he ran last time. He didn't necessarily make it. We'll see what happens. Mike Johnson, I knew who Mike Johnson was, but I was probably one of very few people who he was before, just like you knew him, Julia. He was a backbencher, and not very many people knew who he was. So they dug pretty deep last time, and I think if it happens again, they're going to dig deep again this time. But you know, keep an eye out for Jim Jordan. You know, I always like to see, you might see someone like a Virginia Fox, who's got a lot of tenure and a lot of sway among the members and things like that, who didn't want it but come in, finish out the year, someone like that. It's chaos. It's a good guessing game. And that's kind of why Marjorie Taylor Greene, you know, brought it about. That's what she does. She brings about chaos.
Yeah, it seems like a job that not many people want in this town. But, you know, moving back to the Biden campaign, they've started to target Nikki Haley's supporters. Do you think President Biden can win over her followers? And how much sway could they ultimately have in a general election?
You know, the last time this happened, it was, you know, John McCain going after, anti-Hillary voters, anti-Democratic Hillary voters. I think it's a nice sentiment, but the polling shows in the GOP, I mean, there are a section of Nikki Haley primary voters who are very anti-Trump, but the vast majority of them, they're not necessarily enamored with Trump, but they don't like Joe Biden either. So this is not an either or for them. This is a man, I'm going to just vote for Joe Biden, or maybe I don't show up. If you're Joe Biden, both of those are desired outcomes. If you want to increase your chances of winning, I don't think it's a good use of resources for them to be flipping a lot of Nikki Haley voters, but it's certainly a good press release.
Last week, I asked you about a state house race in Alabama that flipped Republican to Democrat because of abortion and the reproductive rights debate. Well, once again, abortion is set to be on the ballot. Well, once again, we're talking about abortion, and it's set to be on the ballot in Florida this election cycle. But with abortion rights advocates seeing wins in red states like Alabama and Ohio, do you think they can be successful in Florida? And Scott, what does that decision and that ballot measure, what effect does it have not only on the presidential election in Florida, but also on that Senate race where Rick Scott is up for re-election?
Well, let's unpack that. It is affecting the electorate, right? It motivates Democratic voters. It motivates Democratic fundraising. As you noted, we saw that in Ohio. We saw it in places like Kansas. We saw it in that Alabama House district. Is it worth 10, 20, 30 points? Probably not. But in a state like Florida, which you know, Donald Trump is projected to win by 3, 4, 5. Could it make it competitive? Absolutely. I think we're going to see that maybe in a couple other states as well. you know, abortion has proven to be a very salient issue, and all the issues around women's reproductive rights, very salient issue for the Democrats to raise money. It is somewhat salient among the Republicans, but it's more concentrated. Whereas this is, you know, women's reproductive rights is, you know, the polling shows and the focus groups that all Democrats believe it in. You know what? There's a good chunk of Republicans who at least align with some of the more moderate views on women's reproductive rights. And a lot of those people live in Florida. So it's certainly going to make the state interesting. The counter argument is Florida has been trending conservative for a while. You see Ron DeSantis and Rick Scott both talking about moderating their positions around women's reproductive rights, maybe not as much as some of the Democrats want, but certainly, you know, catering to some of that. So, you know, whether it'll certainly make it competitive in Florida, but, you know, around the country, we'll see if some of these ballot issues make some of the other states competitive as well.
Yeah, it'll be certainly something to watch. Speaking of ballots, RFK Jr. scored a major victory and qualified for the ballot in North Carolina. Do you think we can expect him to get on more ballots going forward?
Yeah, no, and, you know, we've been talking about this for a while. 6 months ago, it was kind of one of those things like, well, you know, he's real if he gets on the ballot. You know, he is, his super PAC, which is something he can't control, has been, you know, collecting signatures, things like that. Now, there is another step. The Democrats have hired, you know, brought on a team, you know, to kind of fight RFK, and everyone thinks that's on, you know, TV and commercials, but really it's around challenging ballot access and things like that, because you've got to submit those signatures, you've got to get them approved, and you can challenge them. And so I think he's going to get on some states, but I also think you're going to see the Democrats push back in states like North Carolina, in states like Pennsylvania, in Michigan. But RFK's, you know, team and Aligned Super PAC have shown me one thing: they can raise money and they do know how to read the rules around ballot access. So I think they're going to get on some.
Yeah. And finally, Scott, it seems like the Trump campaign and the Biden campaign, they're certainly concerned about, you know, his potential placement on a number of swing state ballots. How is he currently polling against Biden and Trump? And could he, you know, ultimately be the spoiler?
Yeah, well, look, his speech, he said the quiet part out loud. He said, "I am here to be the spoiler." Now, he said he was going to be here to be the winner, too. I don't know if he's going to be the winner, but he is going to spoil. What we see now is, at least in the initial polling, and it's early, initial polling is he takes away from Biden a little bit more than Trump, and that's largely based on the Kennedy name ID. When we dive into the issues, the Republicans and Democrats who know his issues, they tend to say, "Huh, I resonate with some of those anti-big pharma, some of those more libertarian views he tends to hold, especially around vaccines, pharma, government spending, immigration, things like that." So, you know, if he gets his message out there, I think he could start taking from Republicans as well. You know, it's going to be an all around, you know, a guessing game, at least for another couple of months until we get this. And it's going to be small. You know, if he takes 3-4 points from Trump, or 3-4 points from RFK, and he ends up getting 5 to 7 to 8% in some of these states, certainly not enough to win. But, you know, if you take 5 to 8% away from both candidates in a state like Pennsylvania, it's going to come down to the wire, and every vote matters. And so I think you're going to see both campaigns, Republican and Democrat, Trump and Biden, running two campaigns, once against him and once against the other guy, which we haven't seen, at least like this, probably since Ross Perot in the 90s.
Oh, my goodness. Everyone has their plates full this cycle. Quite a bit to watch. Scott Tranter, as always, thank you for joining us to break it all down.
Thanks for having me.
And that's it for What's America Thinking. Come back next week. Be sure to like, share, and subscribe to The Hill's YouTube channel. And we want to hear from you. Leave your comments and let us know what's on your mind.